Hey watchers, welcome back to the channel to this comparison which I have been wanting to do ever since I ended up with this latest model in hand here. So this is the Omega Seamaster Professional across three generations of the 300M model. Okay, so over on the left we have, just introducing them, the 1993 model. This one is in quartz. So this is the 2541-80-00. Of course, if you consider the mechanical automatic model, is the 2531-80.00, almost identical in terms of external appearances, and we'll go into the details a little bit later. The one in the middle is kind of what I call my old faithful. This is a watch that I keep coming back to over the years. I've owned this for a few years now. So this is a 2012 model, coaxial with lacquer dial, 212-30-41-20-03-001 is the model, all information down the bottom, of course. Okay, so this is a 2012 model, which I've owned for a few years. And then this one is, of course, the latest model. This is a 2018 release, the 210-30-42-20-03-001, which has only just come into my possession. All right, so you know, what are the broad similarities or the common touch pieces across the Seamaster range? They are, of course, 300M, that's the name of the watch. Water rating, 316L steel, everything is made of 316L steel in terms of the case and the bracelet. And the helium escape valve, they all have. This is kind of like a hallmark, which some people don't like, but I don't think they'll ever change it. At the 10 o'clock position, that's a kind of a manual operated helium escape valve. And they all have this, very well known now, Seamaster bracelet, 9-piece per link, right? So 9 individual pieces. And you can see that, you can show it at the back here. It's 9 individual pieces per link on the Seamaster bracelet, all solid components in terms of machine clasps, end links, and whatnot, of course. Okay, so let's just go into the details and kind of compare them across the range and go into what upgrades they have put in across the generations. So starting on the very left here, right, the oldest model, the model that came out in the early 90s, and the quartz model featured, of course, in GoldenEye, and then subsequently automatic models in the later Pierce Brosnan movies. Okay, so 2541-80.00 is the quartz model I have here. Original MSRP, as far as I get it, was around $1,000 USD and about $1,200 USD for the automatic. And what a fantastic piece to buy at that stage if I could travel back in time, right? These days, if you find a good specimen, it's selling a bluff for the original MSRP, of course. Case diameter is 41 millimeters, and the thickness of the quartz model is 11 millimeters. All the information I can find suggests that the automatic was only half a millimeter more at 11.5 millimeters. And the overall weight of this watch is 143 grams with a few links removed to fit me. I imagine the automatic might be slightly heavier, but probably not much heavier. All right, movement in here. The quartz is, an ETA 255461 base. They call it the Omega Caliber 1538. But if you got the automatic, it would be the Omega 1121, which is kind of a slightly updated 2892-A2. So it beats at the full 28800, but it does have a 44-hour reserve with slightly increased jewel count of 23, as opposed to the base, which is 21. Okay, so in terms of lume, I'm not going to detail these ones. They all have dual color superluminova, and they all have a domed sapphire on top of the dial there. The bezel in this case has an aluminium insert. Okay, so this is the most basic bezel, but it does have a very pleasing printing, which people do praise. It has a very clear readout on the markings, right? The minute markings as well as numerals. Very, very clear in this old-fashioned aluminium. The bracelet ends, of course, solid, as I mentioned, but I'll show you this old bracelet is actually push pins, right? Back then they didn't have screw links, they actually stuck with push pins with a kind of a collar fastener. That's what they have. The clasp is, of course, machined, and they all have machine clasps. I'll just show it to you with a push button there. In this case, it does have also a dive extension, and what I'll say is that it has a slim clasp, right? This is a longer clasp body, but it has actually the slimmest clasp body of all of these watches. All right, the strengths, Okay, so it's a 28800 beat per hour cost chronometer. It's got that classic wave dial, which of course is, you know, much liked. You know, some people don't like it, but definitely is a classic icon of this series. This one has a slim bezel, right? The slimmest bezel profile here. It does have that scallop edge, but just looking at that thickness, so just that you see it, and a very good contrast insert there. And the bracelet does taper nicely, so the edge of the bracelet, right, stick it in the middle and it tapers down to the side, and the edge here is the slimmest one of all. So of all these watches, this is the thinnest and lightest model, and including the automatic, is the thinnest and lightest variation. The weaknesses, I'll say, is the hands are a little bit too short, right? You can see the minute hand particularly doesn't reach the minute track, and that is something that a lot of people complained about. The indices are all printed, right? The entire dial is printed. There are no real applied elements here. And it's got a pretty plain date wheel. It's a white date wheel with black printing. They didn't go for a color match date wheel, which, you know, I think in this day and age, it's seen as maybe a slight, you know, cheapening of it. But some people argue that it does preserve the symmetry of the dial because it, you know, it cuts that 3 o'clock marker, but you put that white there, it slightly, you know, helps preserve slight symmetry there. And then the other things I'll mention, of course, is aluminium bezel insert. In this day and age, you won't catch Omega doing that, you know, in the Seamaster range. It's got to be a better material than that. And of course, it's got the pin for the bracelet push pins rather than anything upgraded, such as the screw set or watches in the Seamaster range have today. All right, so that's the old Seamaster, the old Brosnan era Seamaster. Let's move on to the next iteration. Now, there was a wave dial of the coaxial movement, which came out in the late 2000s, but, you know, I don't have that on hand. This really took over from that, and this is the lacquer dial. So 2012 model, original MSRP was 4,004, and I think you probably can get it for under 4,000 still these days, either still ongoing or new old stock. The case size, they've maintained it at 41 millimeters, but the thickness has grown to 13 millimeters. Most of that is that bezel edge, and I'll just show you what I mean. If you see that bezel there, right, most of the thickness is taken up by the increased bezel thickness, slightly by the case back, but mostly by the bezel, I think. Overall weight has grown, 165 grams adjusted weight. And the movement in here, which you probably know, is a 2500 caliber, which is based on the 2892-A2, but of course with that coaxial upgrade, which kind of means they slow it down to 25-200 beats per hour for various reasons, and you can read about that elsewhere. But the power reserve is increased at 48 hours with a jewel count of 27. Okay, the bezel. Right, other differences into upgrades, the bezel is a ceramic insert, but that means the contrast, you know, is lower in this case. That's what they were able to achieve back in the day. They did improve the bracelet, so there's a whole new bracelet with screw links, right, but heavier, right? It doesn't taper quite as much. And the clasps, I'll show you, is a shorter body, but this part here extends past the body of the clasp, and then you've got this bump here. So it's not quite as slimline, and there's some, you know, so some people don't like that. So I don't mind it because you're getting a smaller body here, but, you know, some people don't like that it's a thicker, slightly, you know, more slabbier clasp, I suppose you can say. Okay, so in terms of strengths and improvements in this module, you get the coaxial upgrade, right? You can, you know, there's been a bit of a back and forth debate here, but there's no doubt there's a higher reserve and higher jewel count. And most, you know, sources seem to suggest the coaxial has advantages, particularly in terms of how long it lasts, as well as the accuracy over time. This is what I've read, but let me know if you have other information on whether the coaxial is definitely better or not. What is of no doubt is that the hands have definitely improved, right? They went for full length hands, so the minute hand now reaches the minute track, which, you know, a lot of people applauded and liked, and this is how they improved it. The date wheel is now blue with silver print, which personally I like the color match date wheel. Some people like the symmetry that this one gave, but I actually prefer a color match date wheel, and I like the silver printing that they went with. The bezel, of course, they upgraded it with ceramic, right? That's a material upgrade. And then the screw length on the bracelets is definitely an upgrade, as I've showed you that Overall, because this doesn't have the wave dial and this has a quieter bezel, don't know whether that's deliberate, but definitely is a lower contrast bezel, I think this is the most versatile and the most formal iteration. You know, I'll put this original one on the wrist for you guys to see, and I'll compare it shortly, right? This one's very nice, right? It sits very nicely and lightly, but because it's just got a slightly more sportier look with that dial and bezel, this one, if I put it on for you, right, it's very, very slightly thicker, right? All over the bezel, particularly the case, right, 13 millimeters, slightly more muscular bracelet, and I showed you the clasps as well. But I think overall, it's still a very slim watch. And because it's got a quieter face and bezel, I think this is the most formal of all. That's my opinion. In terms of weaknesses, or I guess things that maybe are not quite an improvement over the old model, it's slightly thicker. I've showed you that, and mostly that's due to the thicker bezel. And maybe that's to compensate for ceramic, which is slightly more brittle. I know they had to make the bezel more meaty. Some people say that. I don't know for sure, and Omega don't say so. It's a lower contrast bezel insert. There's no doubt about it, right? See it side by side. It's harder to read, and therefore less, you know, utility out of this particular bezel. So that's something that people, one of the biggest complaints I would say is actually the bezel visibility. And then the slightly flabbier bracelet, if you will. I don't mind it, you know, this is still pretty slim to me, but it's definitely a flabbier, you know, just a heavier bracelet. If you weigh this independently, I'm sure it would be a heavier bracelet. And then it's got that thicker clasps, right, which I've kind of explained to you guys. Okay, so let's just put that down and move on to the newest model. So guys, this is the 210-3042-2030-3001, released just in 2018. Original MSRP, amazingly, they didn't increase a lot at all, just 10% to 4,850. Of course, they did increase it earlier this year, again to 5,200. But most people still think this is still pretty darn compelling value for money for everything that they put in this watch. All right, so the case has increased in size this time, 42 millimeters, and the thickness has also increased as a result, 13.6. And I think in this case, if I put this side by side, it's mainly taken up by the actual case, right? The bezel is quite similar. The case back is quite similar. So most of that thickness increase is from the case itself. Hopefully you can appreciate that. Overall, it is, of course, going to be a heavier watch being larger, 174 grams adjusted weight. All right, in here, movement wise, in this case, it's gone to the in-house caliber Omega 8800. It is still the coaxial with 25-200 beats per hour, but they've increased the power reserve to 55, and it's got a very high joule count for a three-handed date. It's a 35 joule count movement here. All right, so the ceramic bezel insert, all right, side by side again, just to show you, so much more visible, right? So this one is what they call liquid metal, which is white enamel, which has been put into grooves that are laser cut into this blue ceramic insert to give that beautiful high contrast look here. The bracelet, of course, remains screw links, but the clasps, I'll just show you, right? It's gone back to the long body. So if you close the clasps, it's kind of like the fully integrated clasp, but it's definitely a much thicker one than the old one. So I'll just show you side by side, right? It's definitely a more muscular, thicker body than the original clasps there. All right, put that down. But I tell you, in terms of the upgrade, there's no doubt, you know, they've really pushed the margin here. So it's solid dive extension, but with the micro adjustment. I know this is not glide lock like Rolex. I don't know whether they have a nickname for this, but if you see that, it's got about, you know, I think 1.2 centimeters of micro adjust on the fly here, which is fantastic, you know, that you can do that now, whereas previously they never had that, which was obviously a weakness of the Omega bracelets in the past, or at least the Seamaster bracelet. And I know you could get an upgrade, but you had to fork out, you know, extra money for the Planet Ocean, which did have that micro adjust earlier than the Seamaster 300M. Okay, so let's talk about the objective upgrades here. So there's no doubt the movement is an upgrade, right? They've gone for a coaxial, fully in-house movement this time, and they've gone for a higher certification, not just cost chronometer, but they've got Meta certification with more stringent testing requirements and a fantastic anti-magnetic properties in terms of 15,000 Gauss. And you can look at my review of this watch for the details on Meta's testing in greater detail, or look at the Omega website itself. But it's just possibly the highest stringency of testing that has been introduced in Swiss watch movements so far, or at least that's one of the claims that Omega make. There are other stringent in-house standards, but this is definitely pretty darn stringent, I would say. They've gone back to a wave dial, right? Ceramic laser cut this time, which is obviously different to the old wave dial, right? This time it's cut into the ceramic, and it's also a, I guess you can say, lower frequency wave, whereas the previous one was definitely kind of closer together, the wave of the old Brosnan era ones. They've gone for rhodium plating on all the indices as well as the hands. And then the other thing I forgot to mention about this one is that from the old Brosnan era, this one also went for applied indices and applied Omega logo there. This one remains applied, but that Omega seems to be more of a thick printing now. Rhodium all over the steel in the dial that you can see there, including the hands and all the indices as well as the seconds hand there. Okay, so and then I've mentioned the enamel in the bezel, right? That's the first for the Seamaster 300M with this clear contrast here, and then that micro adjustable clasp, right? Those are the objective upgrades. In terms of the overall watch, there is no doubt that size apart, everything has been overhauled and improved, at least in terms of being harder to make. But with the 42 millimeters, with the thicker case size and the heavier watch, as well as the bolder appearance, there's no doubt it's a lot more sporty and tall. It is also the least versatile of all these pieces, at least that's my view of it. It does stand out a bit more, it's a bit less formal. I still can wear this at work with a shirt and tie, but I think if you were going to wear a black tie suit, this one probably sneaks in better than this one. That's my view of it. Okay, so there we go. That's my comparison across three generations of these really beautiful watches here. I'll just adjust it back for the close up here. So, three Omega Seamasters from the early 90s to the 2018 model. Let me know your thoughts on this. I would like to hear, your experiences if you own any of these, or perhaps even more than one of these. Would love to hear your insights in the time that you've had with the watch. Guys, there we go. My comparison of this. Thank you for watching. If you enjoy my videos, do consider subscribing. I put out new content every week, always aiming to be objective and unbiased about all things horology. Thank you again for sticking with me, and as always, I'll catch you guys again.